On July 8th, 2012, exactly 10 years ago, the first season of Sword Art Online started airing and forever altered the history of anime. This penultimate escapist fantasy's success was also unknowingly aided by the timing of its release. I want to make a short overview of Isekai and Sword Art Online and give my thoughts as to why it became such a big thing. Let's make something clear though, Isekai was already a thing before SAO. I mean, come on.
How many of you have seen Tron?
Stories about being transported to another world have existed as long as humans did. That's what The Divine Comedy and Alice in Wonderland, for example, are about. It was always appealing to think what life would be like somewhere else if only we were in a more interesting world. In the context of the anime community, these stories are a vessel for otaku escapism. Instead of a completely fictional character within a world, a normal, everyday human from our world, much like the otaku, is transported to a more entertaining world. Isn't that far more relatable and exciting than any old shonen plot? Goes the idea. And to many, it was, which is why Isekai has existed for a while, starting with Takachiho Haruka's Warrior from Another World from 1976, a story of a high schooler summoned to another world to fight the Demon King. Sound familiar? When digital computers were invented in the latter half of the 20th century, it brought another dimension to escapism, as now virtual worlds were also accessible for storytelling. Even more so when video games were invented, allowing people to have an interactive component and actually be a character in another world, with various RPGs for various console and home computer systems taking center stage. Combined, all of the above led to a boom in Isekai in the 80s and 90s, with anime such as Spirit Hero Wataru or Magic Knight Rayearth defining the emerging genre and competing with the likes of Dragon Ball and Sailor Moon for popularity. Around the same time, virtual reality also became a thing, as at the internet and a bit later, MMOs. And of course, that too became a vessel for storytelling, with the notable example of Hacksign and the .hack franchise in general, combining them and popularizing the trapped in a video game MMO concept in the early 2000s. Right then, in 2001, a young author by the name of Kawahara Reki wrote a short story for the Dengeki Game Novel Award competition and titled it Sword Art Online, likely inspired by his experiences playing the 90s MMO Ultima Online. Although ultimately rejected, he turned his story into a web novel and kept on writing, and in 2008 successfully won the same competition with another work, Excel World, a similar story to SAO. The organizers noticed his earlier work and pushed for its publication, so ironically, Sword Art Online was brought into the limelight by the other Sword Art Online, the first volume being published that same year in 2008. Also, ironically, Excel World would get an anime adaptation one season prior to SAO airing, and wouldn't be nearly as notable. Meanwhile, the world itself was advancing technologically, the 90s aesthetic of the early and mid-2000s being replaced with a sort of neo-futurism, but this time backed by smartphones, fingerprint scanners, video chat, the Kinect. It seemed like the future was closer than ever. If you were a kid at this time, you definitely remember the many articles and books about things that we would have by 2020. Space hotels, flying cars, robot assistants, virtual classrooms, the whole lot. A new decade of unparalleled progress seemed ahead, and in this atmosphere, 2012 arrived, and A1 Pictures decided to adapt the first four volumes of Kawahara's work. The premise was simple. A young teenager finds himself trapped in this new virtual reality game with a medieval setting, and the only way out was to beat it. It wasn't anything new or special, but it was perfectly timed. The hype for technological advancement was there, smartphones and accessibility to the internet was higher than ever, anime had just entered a new decade with tons of groundbreaking shows releasing in 2011, and new fans from a new generation of otaku and ordinary teenagers were getting hooked. And there it was, SAO, this cool-looking anime about a video game set in a VR world. It was so hype because, well, it was kinda real. In fact, Oculus announced their Rift a month later, and it seemed like by the time we reached the show's 2022, virtual reality games like Sword Art Online would be reality, and you could actually be trapped in a video game. Woo! All of a sudden, A1 Pictures had hit the goldmine with otaku and gamers flocking to watch this exciting new show that also promised an epic adventure, flashy battles, factions, and who knows what else. With the fans and money flowing in, the whole industry shifted to the concept. Isekai and fantasy webland light novels with a medieval setting and RPG mechanics suddenly finding themselves being offered adaptations with the backing of big budget studios. And while SAO ended up being quite disappointing for those looking for an anime depicting a proper MMO, most seemed unswayed by how painfully boring it was, and a generation of fans were now firmly devoted to its universe and ideas. SAO's second season was thus massively anticipated along with Akame ga Kill and what promised to be a fantastic summer season in 2014, though both ended up being disappointing and underwhelming. Nevertheless, the franchise continued being very profitable, with the 2017 movie Ordinal Scale earning $30 million worldwide and Alicization and War of the Underworld continuing to keep the franchise in the mind of the public for the last of the decade, firmly placing SAO in the public mind for the entirety of the 2010s. The public opinion had meanwhile slowly shifted from direct hate to a sense of nostalgia as the teenagers who watched it initially grew up, and as the isekai genre itself became increasingly saturated by stories that felt ever more generic, which in turn made adaptations that stood out in their writing, premise, worldbuilding, whatever, that much more appealing, with shows such as Lock Horizon, No Game No Life, ReZero, Konosuba, Yojo Senki, Shield Hero, That Time I Got Reincarnated as a Slime, and Mushoku Tensei as the most notable for their respective years, 2013 onwards. Non-isekai novels that still use the generic isekai setting, most notably Danmachi, directly competed. I'd even argue that the colorful, color-saturated, smaller eyes and slimmer character style present in fantasy stories in the 2010s was directly spurred by SAO's success, as was the entrenchment of light novels as THE way to get your story into the otaku community as a fantasy writer. While all of this is debatable, I just couldn't imagine the previous decade would play out the same way without that one fateful A1 adaptation in 2012. Who knows if we would have even gotten fantastic works like Lock Horizon's anime, a story by gamers for gamers, what SAO should have been, or even isekai novels would have survived the decade. My life would also have been different. I was so enamored by SAO that I literally trained my right arm to sway less during walking to emulate me holding a sword and prepare me for when I would be trapped in a video game. And while I don't care for it anymore, I do have strong feelings for its second season, Alternative GGO, and the Alicization light novels. I think it's reasonable to say SAO's adaptation played a crucial part in bringing the whole subgenre into the mainstream, becoming to the 2010s what Haruhi was to the 2000s. A paradigm shift. So, love it or hate it, it's fair to say that it deserves at least this. Happy birthday, SAO. Here's to another 10.